Hi, welcome all of you on channel of Yourpedia Education, and you are watching the series of interaction with the visionaries. In today's such interaction, I'm going to interact with the real erudite and visionary personality, Dr. Selva Murthy. You know, Dr. Selva Murthy he spent almost his entire research and academic career in DRDO, Defense Research Development Organization of India, Premium Research Institute of India, and he has done a lot of work for the soldiers, especially working in high altitude areas like Siachen Glacier and all. So Dr. Selva Murthy is a very diverse profile he has, and you will surely enjoy his interaction, his vision, his views. Presently, Dr. Selva Murthy is joined MIT University. He's a chancellor of MIT University, Chhattisgarh. And from research domain to educational domain, we can see for the last 6-7 years since he's there with MIT University, he has brought transformation in that also. And MIT University has come to the second level of filing of the patents based upon good quality research work. After IITs, so IIT system has collectively highest patenting which are filed from India, and then comes MIT University. So we will interact with Dr. Selva Murthy in detail. So before I go for that, let me tell you something about sir. Dr. Selva Murthy he joined DRDO in 1973, and almost 4 decades he spent in DRDO. He has been the director of, in fact, one of the youngest directors. In early 40s, he became the director of 2 institutes in DRDO, which is DIPAS and DIPR. And his majority of research work is related to psychological domains and physiological domains. So he has been the distinguished scientist. That is the highest, I think, the level of hierarchy in the hierarchy, or highest level of hierarchy in research defense institutes, and then chief controller of R&D, CCR&D in DRDO. If we see further, Dr. Selva Murthy, he is a postgraduate in human physiology from Christian Medical College, Vellore. So if you see his background, he's from this particular background, and that is reflected in his research areas also. And further, he did his PhD from University of Delhi and Doctorate of Science from Anusandhan Samsthan, Vivekanand Yoga Anusandhan Samsthan. So after that, Dr. Selva Murthy, if you see presently, Dr. Selva Murthy is with the MIT University. He is the president of MIT Science, Technology and Innovation Foundation. And he is also the Director General for MIT Directorate of Science and Innovation, and the Chancellor of MIT University, Chhattisgarh. So as I told you that he's one of his main contribution in education domain is that MIT University has come to the level where maximum patents are being filed after IIT system from MIT University. So that also I have discussed with Dr. Selva Murthy, how this has come up. If we see various kind of research work done by Dr. Selva Murthy, that is physiological acclimatation at high altitude. You know, Siachen Glacier is world's highest battleground, as you already know. So there our soldiers face lot of troubles, you know. So how to acclimatize at such high altitude? So Dr. Murthy has done very commendable work in that direction. So application of yoga for armed forces, so that is also one of his domain. And in the interview he says that at this age also I very quickly can climb up and down the stairs and all, though there's a lift but I don't use it. So that is, I think, thanks to yoga. He discovered a drug which actually could be used to save wire casualties in severe hemorrhage issues, psychological stress and its management, and life support system for soldiers. That is the domain he's done. Then during the interview I asked him about his close association with Kalam, our ex-president and great scientist of India. So Dr. Kalam was very closely associated with Dr. Selva Murthy, his close friend of Dr. Kalam. And if you see, there's a book, Wings of Fire, the 4 full pages are basically In those four pages, Dr. Kalam has mentioned about Selvamurthy, my friend Selvamurthy. So that is also we will see. Now, what kind of question, you know, whenever I interact with some visionary, I make some kind of questionnaire. So I ask some questions, which you will find the answers in the interaction. So what questions I asked him? I asked him that Dr. Murthy has done tremendous work in R&D domains, how he got into R&D as a career, how he chose this R&D career. And his biomedical research work in DRDO, something about that he will tell us. And how can researcher make their research more society oriented? Then he talks about the health research and how budding researchers can basically use their research for such applications in day-to-day life. And how can somebody become edupreneur or entrepreneur in the field of science and technology? So his journey from research and development in DRDO to his educational domain in MIT University, that is what we discussed. And then he talks about the vision for educational institutes and how to motivate and bring the best brain into research. And then he talks about little bit about self-reliant or Atmanirbhar Bharat and his advice, piece of advice to future technocrat. Believe me, this entire interaction is very, very quality enriched, and a lot of concepts and ideas you will get it. So be patient, and whenever you have sufficient time, then you sit and listen to entire interaction with Dr. Selvamurthy. So let's now go and start and listen interaction with Dr. Selvamurthy.
Dr. Selvamurthy, I welcome you on our platform, that is Yourpedia, and I'm Dr. Vijender, and sir, it is great honor today to talk to you. I'm already going to introduce you in my video, but one line I would like to tell about you. Sir, you have spent almost 40 years in DRDO as a CCR&D, and then presently you are in MIT University, you are Chancellor of MIT University. And sir, you are a visionary fellow who has transformed not only research and development in the field of defense, but also, sir, now you have brought a lot of changes in the field of education also. Actually, what is required, R&D part in educational institutes. So I would like to interact with you, sir, and I would like to ask certain things from you. And I'm very sure this interaction is going to help lakhs of the students in India and abroad.
Thank you very much, Mr. Vijayender Thakur.
Thanks a lot, sir.
It's a pleasure to interact with you, and we need young leaders like you who can take the message through media to people. And it's very important when some of the people who have achieved certain made a mark in life, they must also share that with the population. So you are in that mission to disseminate the knowledge, information from people with some experience to the students and other public as well. So I compliment you on this initiative, and I'm sure you'll do very well.
And thanks a lot, sir.
Best wishes for you, for thanks, your life, and God bless you.
Thanks a lot. Sir, I heard your name first time when I started my career as a scientist in DRDO long back in 2001. I joined one of the labs in Dehradun, and there I heard about you from my director and senior scientist. And they used to talk very high about you, sir. So my first question to you, sir, is like you have spent 40 years in research and it's certain domains, which are niche domains you have worked in. Sir, first my question is from where you got this motivation to go for R&D or research career in your life? What was the reason and what was the motivation behind that?
Right. Thank you very much. And when I look back my own biography, I was born in a village. You know, it's a very small village in Tamil Nadu. And also I was brought up there till my school education. So the school is there only up to 8th standard in that village known as Kilayirar. It is in Tirunelveli district at that time. And then my father did not have even money to send me to college, because then my maternal uncle supported my education. Then I got scholarships and studied. What I want to say is destiny shapes itself, and God shows the path and trajectory where you will be successful, happy in life. So you may dream something, you may plan something, and you may set certain goals, But then God may have a different plan. He may write a different beautiful chapter for you. See, in my life, as far as I understand, from a boy from a village who studied in Tamil medium school, in those village school, which is only up to 8th standard, then I have to go cycling 4 miles to study my the higher secondary education. Then I went to St. Xavier's College, Padangottai, then Christian Medical College, Vellore. I did my master's. Then I went to Delhi University to do my PhD. So it all happened because, I come from a very modest family, very poor family in a village. And so this is really a God's blessing for me that I got into this. But what interested me was science. When I was studying in school itself, I used to hear about a ship loaded with wheat coming to ports of Bombay, Goa to feed our people. I used to be wondering at that young age because, in village, there used to be only wild radio. There's no transistor or TV at that time. So my periyappa, that's my uncle's house, had a radio. So I used to, 6 o'clock in the evening, there is a All India Radio news used to come. So at that time, I was knowing that we didn't have even food to feed 30 crore people at that time. Then I heard also when I entered into college, I was hearing about M.S. Swaminathan, Green Revolution, agricultural scientists. So I was wondering, you can solve problems of the society through science. So that is the idea which stuck in my mind. Then I thought I will study. I got scholarships and studied very well, and put all my energy only on studies and development. Then it was a sojourn. Then when I actually entered into I was doing my PhD in St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. At that time, I got a call from DRDO that there is a post of Junior Scientific Assistant, JSA. So I applied for it. But sometime there was no, it was very silent. But suddenly I got one telegram, can you come for interview to, then that was my transformation. So I left my PhD halfway at St. John's Medical College and rushed to DRDO. That was the turning point in my life that I moved on, who didn't move out of the boundaries of Tamil Nadu or at the maximum Bangalore. I came to Delhi. I didn't know Hindi at that time. अभी तो बहुत हिंदी सीख लिया पर उस दैट टाइम हिंदी भी नहीं जानता था सो आई वाज रियली इट वाज अ वेरी कल्चरल शॉक फॉर मी व्हेन आई मूव्ड इन फॉर इंटरव्यू इटसेल्फ
ओके
एंड दैट वाज द हिस्ट्री देन माय जर्नी डीआरडीओ गेव मी द प्लेटफॉर्म फॉर एक्सप्रेसिंग ऑल माय ड्रीम्स इट आई ग्रो विद डीआरडीओ एंड सो 40 इयर्स इन डीआरडीओ इज अ बिग पीरियड द प्राइम पार्ट ऑफ डेवलपमेंट आई वाज एबल टू मेक अ कंट्रीब्यूशन So it is actually not only motivation which was driving me, but God was, destiny was shaping itself for me and took me to DRDO. And that gave me the platform for my self-expression. Maybe that I had the potentials. I had the milieu and the inherent strength. But DRDO, Defense Research and Development Organization, gave me the right motivation. I became director at the age of 40, and it's a history. I made history there.
You became director of 2 labs, sir.
Yeah, of 2 labs. And then I also got 3rd lab in mass after some time. Then as chief controller R&D for almost 10 labs. Then all, I used to be officiating whenever the SA2RM was away. I was second in command in terms of operating in DRDO. So why I'm telling all this, a boy coming from a village, from a poor family, destiny has shaped itself. But then, maybe that I had those karmic account in me, which I brought it with my atma. So that propelled me, and I believe strongly in God. And I'm still having the total faith in that supreme power. So that drives me. So the transition to DRDO R&D was not just by chance, but then it was by destiny, which shaped itself. Because I wanted to be a practicing doctor. My dream actually, when I was a boy, I used to make like a stethoscope, toy stethoscope some people used to have. So I used to act like a doctor. Okay. So my dream was actually to be a medical doctor, but then I became a medical scientist, a physiologist. Okay. So that is why maybe that I may not have made a mark as a doctor, but I made a satisfactory impact as a scientist, medical scientist, and defense scientist.
Right.
So that is that's the journey, Vijay.
Okay.
I enjoyed my stay, and DRDO is a great organization.
Great organization. Professor Salvamurthy, my next question is related to biomedical research work only. Sir, you have done a lot of work in physiological and psychological domains for soldiers. Certain domains where no work was done earlier, you have done a lot of work in that. So, sir, I would like to ask you whether your background of medical and physiology is the reason behind that, and from where you got these ideas, and why this particular domain?
Right. See, the defense R&D has got two major components. One is the equipment weapon systems, that is the one system, very important. You need latest technologies to fight a war. Technology drives the doctrines of a nation in war and peace. So you need good technology. So that is one aspect, very important aspect.
Right.
Then we also had another important aspect is, how do you keep the soldiers, the man behind the weapon, fighting fit? That is important, equally important. You may have a best systems. Your systems are not going to fight themselves. It has to be operated by a human being, the soldiers in uniform. So how do you integrate these two, a high technology equipment and weapon system, with a highly efficient, motivated soldier? That is the winning point for any war. So that is what we created in DRDO. So we focused on both. One side, we developed missiles, aircraft, radars, sonars, torpedoes, materials, and all those. The other side, we developed life support technologies, like how do you acclimatize a soldier to high altitude, cold area, desert, underwater, aerospace, low intensity conflict environments. So how do you keep the soldiers fighting fit in those conditions and giving their best for the nation in terms of combat efficiency and also motivation? So this whole gamut was looked after by the life sciences laboratories. So I joined first at the Defense Institute of Physiology and Allied Sciences, as JSA. And then we looked at, the priority was high altitude. At that time, after 1962 Chinese aggression, then the focus was on how do you keep the soldiers fighting fit with highest performance of combat efficiency at high altitude. So we looked at acclimatization pattern, tenure of posting, what type of nutrition we should give, the calories, composition, what type of protective clothing we need to provide to them, what type of fighting equipments, shelters we need to provide, the oxygen delivery systems, how do we prevent diseases like acute mountain sickness, high altitude pulmonary edema, and such conditions we looked at in that laboratory. And also we developed ergonomics as one of the important factor there. How do you match the human factors with the machine capability, so that there's a man-machine interface matching is optimal, which is very important for the effective utilization of the weapon system. So right from anthropometric designs and also ergonomics, noise, vibration, toxic fumes when ammunition is fired, the occupational health and safety of soldier, everything comes in that domain. Then comes, so we have in life sciences, then when I grew as the CCR&D, we were looking at the life science in totality, right from selection, placement, nutrition, clothing, personal protective equipment, man-machine interface, acclimatization to environment, improving human performance, military motivation, then chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear, defense technologies. So all this I looked after. But in addition, I was also given responsibility on the other management side, human resource, 30,000 people in DRDO, 10,000 scientists, 12,000 technical people, and about equal number of people in the support staff. So I managed them as the CCR&D HR. Then I was also given the responsibility of CCR&D for international cooperation. So I could sign MOUs, enter into collaboration with other countries for R&D. So that gave me all this opportunity. I was involved in every aspect of DRDO governance at that point of time. But then DRDO biomedical research helped the soldiers, and right from selection process, we evolved the selection. How do you select the right person? Because everybody cannot be a soldier. need that metal in you, that leadership in you. So how do you select officers? How do you select men? Then having selected, how do you assign duties in terms of placement for the other ranks, and how do you place them, the right man on the right job? So we look up the aptitude test, sort of for the trade allocation. Then we look at the psychological stress of isolation, monotony, separation from family, fear of the unknown, which will be acting on soldiers in different occupational environments, operational conditions. So we looked at them. Then what are the stress levels? How do you manage the stress in soldiers? And how do you prevent suicides and fratricide occasionally if it happens? It's very, very rare, but even that is important to prevent even the life of one soldier. So we were looking at the military psychology in a big way, including developing a pilot aptitude battery test. So far, it's a computerized pilot selection. Now it has been
introduced.
I initiated that, and now
So that was initiated by you, sir?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Now it is the Air Force has introduced in all the Dehradun Air Force Station.
Yes.
As well as in Mysore, as well as Varanasi. So they have introduced this pilot computerized pilot selection system.
Right.
So the like that, if you see, the DRDO is a great organization. I would say it is the best R&D organization, not in the country, but in the world.
Right.
The reason is the challenges are very huge, right from strategic, that India became a nuclear power and DRDO contributed immensely along with Atomic Energy, Department of Atomic Energy. And Dr. Kalam was the SA2RM at that time, scientific advisor to Raksha Mantri. And Vajpayee government was there at that time. So he gave nod to go ahead. So Pokhran 2 happened. And DRDO played a very important role in executing it so well without anybody knowing that what we were doing. So in DRDO's role, people may not know that type of role. Then we also have 30% of our DRDO effort on strategic defense. That is, we have to have second strike capability, having signed a self-moratorium of no first use. We must have the capability for a second strike from land, air, water, underwater. So today DRDO has developed that. And if you look at the missiles, we have developed a large family of missiles, Agni, Prithvi, Akash, Nag, Trishul, Brahmos, interceptor missile, Shaurya, Astra, you name anything, it is there. So we done missiles in spite of all technology control regime, like NPT, CTBT, and all those control regime, we were able to do that. So today we can deliver a strategic payload, a nuclear payload, 1 ton over a distance of 5,000, 6,000 kilometers, intercontinental ballistic missile we have been able to develop. So missile, we are very strong. Yes. Because in missile, it is just not only you see a rocket taking off, but it is actually the materials technology, then control, guidance, navigation, propulsion. Everything goes into that. Mm-hmm. Computation. So people don't realize that. They saw only a rocket going up. But a lot of research and development takes place to develop. And if it is surface-to-air missile, surface-to-surface missile, air-to-air missile, air-to-surface missile, all this is a lot of how do you identify a target? How do you send the missile to the target? And even now, interceptor missile for exo-atmospheric, endo-atmospheric interception, we have developed the capability. And then ballistic missile defense capability we have got now. Now, the latest one, Dr. Satish Reddy, who is the present chief of DRDO, chairman of DRDO, and he has demonstrated the most important asset. You know, the anti-satellite missile, ASAT, anti-satellite missile. So this is a great achievement that with precision, kinetic energy, we were able to destroy one of the satellites of our own. So these are the capability in missile. When you look at the aeronautics, today we have developed capability, the LCA is a reality, which has been injected into that, into this Sulur in Coimbatore. We have put two squadron are getting ready, and more than 40 aircrafts have been delivered, another 80 are in the pipeline to join there. So see the capability, a DRDO with small nucleus of scientists and technical people. Then in terms of radars, we have delivered a large number of radars, like starting from Indra PC radar, Rajendra Pacer radar, Central Acquisition radar. Then we have a large family of radars have been developed. And then Revati, Rohini, all this type for Navy, Air Force, Army. And now the latest one is the airborne early warning and control system, which is comes in the aeronautics as well as in the radars, because it's basically a radar. And then we have also developed in terms of the electronic warfare, Samyukta for Army, Sangraha for Navy, and also airborne, the electronic warfare system. So electronics we have done very well. And if you do the main battle tank in combat vehicles and engineering, we have delivered. Why I'm telling, it's a great organization, MBT, yes, yes. 124 tanks are introduced, MBT Mark II is under development, and we have armored amphibious vehicle, armored ambulance, and a bridge layer tank, Sarvatra, large number of the combat vehicles have been inducted. Similarly, when you look at radars, sonars, torpedoes, sonars for the Navy, and torpedoes for Navy, and sonobuoys. So then nano application in defense, I coordinated as the chief of the nano mission in DRDO. The nanotechnology application in different spheres of defense requirements to improve the efficiency. So that gave me a complete know of what is. Then the next important thing is life sciences. In the life support technologies, we developed them, right from the selection technologies, then the combat systems like paratrooper, we gave the ensemble. Then CBRN, protective ensemble. What you see in COVID-19 today, many of them are spin-offs which have come from that that tacit knowledge of building the protective ensemble for CBRN, chemical, biological, radiological protection. Okay. So now that spin-off is seen today in the COVID-19 as the individual protective ensembles, IPEs and PPE. Then the next thing, we had food technologies. In Mysore, we have a food lab where a large number of processed foods we started giving to the soldiers, like meals ready to eat, like vegetable pulao, mutton pulao, suji halwa, like this, energy bars, to give instant food to the soldiers because they have no time to cook in operational conditions. So we have meals ready to eat developed. Then we have agriculture lab, three agricultural labs, which looks into food development in extreme environments like high altitude. There is a Defense Institute of High Altitude Research. Like earlier it used to be Field Research Laboratory, FRL, now it is known as DIHAR. They have given agricultural technologies, like how do you cultivate vegetables like tomato, brinjal, onion, garlic, mustards, at that sub-zero temperature in Leh, which is almost about 3,000, more than 3,500 kilometers, 500 kilometer altitude, 500 meters altitude, sorry. And then we have also developed, 5,000 metric tons of vegetables are produced locally by DRDO technology. So that if you have to take everything from Chandigarh or Delhi from planes, it will cost a lot of money. 1 kg of tomato will cost 150 rupees per transportation by fuel, you know, by aircraft it has to go there. So that is, and you may not get it fresh. Yes. So see the impact of the soldier's health. As it is said, army marches on its stomach. That means food is important for a soldier. So that we give fresh food. So if you give one green chili and a 1,000 rupee note, soldier will take this one green chili. he'll not say, no, I don't need 1,000 rupees, I need a green chili. We produce that through the life sciences lab of DRDO. Sibaktan, there is another important plant in which labor juice we brought out. And then we developed hybrid cows, which gives about 20 liters milk per each animal. And we had developed 40 of these cows, hybrid cows. Because if I take a high yield, milk yielding cow from plains like Sahiwal, it may not survive there. But then we were able to make a hybrid, the sperm of the yak and the ovum of the Sahiwal cow, we made the hybrid. Today, you know, the 40 cows are living there, and we are giving the calves to the local people. So in the process, local people economy, developed because they sell the milk to the army. And the vegetable, 5,000 metric tons of vegetables are given to the army. So the agriculture science we have done in those extreme conditions using microbial technology.
So DRDO is into everything, sir, that way.
Absolutely. This is the only organization. That's why
yes,
I said
yes.
This greatest organization.
Yes.
All this with minimum. What I said, the canvas with minimum manpower. Similarly, the CBRN, Chemical, Biological, Radiological, Nuclear Technology, Defense Technology. We have developed right from early detection, personal protection, collective protection, decontamination, medical management. All this whole canvas, we have developed technologies and introduced. Today, if you put a value of all technology developed by DRDO, manufactured in India, and inducted into the services, and the production value, if you see, it is almost more than 2 lakh crores. 2 lakh crores worth of system have been developed, inducted, and many of them are in production now. The supply orders have been received. You take one missile, Akash missile. 45,000 crores worth of orders have been received from Army, Navy, Air Force. Similarly, BrahMos, which is the fastest supersonic cruise missile. Many countries want, including US, may not have the technology. We have cooperation from Russia. And it's a joint venture with Russia. So yes. What I'm telling you is DRDO, that is why DRDO is the greatest.
Yes, yes.
Minimal manpower, minimal budget. Today, it is about 18,000 crores is the total budget. But it used to be a few hundred crores, few thousand crores. Now it has come to this level. But then we need to do much more. The expectation, aspirations have gone up. And the present government with Atmanirbhar, self-reliance, DRDO is going to have a glorious future ahead. And in this period, it's a golden era for DRDO.
Dr. Selvamurthy, you mentioned about Dr. Kalam. So I cannot control my this thing. I want you to tell us something about Dr. Kalam because you have been very close to him. So yes. Anything you want to tell us about that?
He was my mentor,
yes.
Philosopher, guide, and a spiritual guru as well,
okay.
And a great friend.
Okay.
He moved with me like a friend. He, in fact, if you see his book on Ignited Minds.
Yes, sir.
He has written 4 pages about my association with him, where he mentions my friend Selvamurthy. That is a big, like, Nobel Prize for me. Such a great man who is Bharat Ratna and a great soul, noble soul. And mentioning me as my friend Dr. Selvamurthy in that book, read that page number 89 to 92 of Ignited Minds. So Dr. Kalam mentions that. That is a big gratitude which I have to express for him, such designating him, me as his friend. That is greatness. So I had 20 years of close association with him. And we have moved, we have eaten together, we have been singing together, and then also running in the Mughal garden when he was president. I used to go for walks and running after the peacocks, counting the rabbits in the Rashtrapati Bhavan. So we had spent greater moments. We used to sing at night. He used to call me Selvamurthy. Sing that Tamil song, we'll sing together. So he will sing from Rashtrapati Bhavan, I will sing from here.
Okay.
About a poetry, Tamil poetry, which is very close to his heart. So whenever he sees me, he used to ask me like that. So I have, he's a great man. First of all, he's a great human being. Before I consider him as Bharat Ratna, president, scientist, technologist, technocrat. He was a great human being, great integrated personality, man of integrity, personification of integrity, compassion, love, and only his breathing is India, India, India. India he breathes in, India he breathes. So the whole breath is India. That was his, he dedicated himself totally for this world. And his passion was to develop the youngsters. And one vision he had for India was developed India. All meetings he used to say, India must have a second vision. What was the first vision? To get independence for the country, to make India a free country. That was achieved. So what is the second vision? Second vision is to make India a developed India, India a superpower. So that was his dream. So a great man. I'm blessed to have worked with such people. I learned quite a lot from him, how to deal with people, how to face challenges in life. All this I learned from him. Many things I learned from him.
That's true, sir. Professor Solamurthy, my next question I would like to ask you is, sir, your journey from research and development domain in DRDO, and I can see the passion, you also breathing DRDO and everything, sir, from that passion to academics. Now you are also chancellor of MIT University, and you have transformed there because MIT University is now number 2 in producing the patents after IITs. So sir, how this transition from research and development to academics? That is what I would like to know.
Right. I actually started my career, if you see, in St. John's Medical College before DRU.
Right, sir.
I was a tutor. I was a tutor in physiology. My career started as a teaching professional in an academic college. It's a medical college, professional college. And so I used to love teaching.
Right, sir.
How do we convey a message or a curriculum to the students? So I used to plan some analogies, some stories, so that it reaches the mind and heart of the students. So I used to really prepare so well for taking a class or delivering a seminar and or a tutorial. So I started my career as a teacher. Then subsequently, when I came to DRDO, I used to interact with many academic institutions, because that is important. DRDO worked with more than 800 institutions outside, including IITs, NITs, universities, including private universities like MIT. So we build a strong interface. DRDO built a strong interface with academia, and we established centers of excellence in universities, DRDO centers in universities and academic institutions. Mm-hmm. Like in IIT, we developed a research and innovation park in IIT Madras, where we brought industry, we brought IIT faculties, PhD scholars, and with DRDO. So like this, Bharatiyar University Coimbatore, we built a DRDO Bharatiyar University Center of Excellence in Life Sciences. So in life sciences, we developed a center in university. Similarly, high energy materials, we developed a center in Hyderabad, Central University Hyderabad. So why I am telling this, that DRDO was connected at that time. I used to closely work with academic institution, because the seeding of ideas can happen in universities. Like even in missile technology, Yadavpur University wrote the algorithm, the software for the control and guidance for a missile. How do you target, how do you control, navigate? So all this is, so many things can come from academics. So I used to interact closely with academia, and I used to give projects, monitor them, visit, go and see, and I used to send the directors to go and see these places, because DRDO has a limited number of the scientists. You cannot increase that number. But how do you have extended arm of the DRDO is to have connectivity, sign MOUs, give projects. So they become your extended arm of DRDO. So I developed that concept that we must intensify our interactions with universities. So we used to consider them as an extended arm of DRDO. I will have 10,000 scientists here, but if I have another 20,000 the faculties, research scholars working outside, they are my people. They are not physically on my payroll in DRDO, but they are working for DRDO in their own labs. So this is the concept we built there. So I used to work with academia. I used to see the research scholars, PhD scholars, young faculty. I said, this is the place where I must go after superannuation, where I will bridge with the DRDO R&D experience and with academia, because universities must become cradle of innovation. Universities must become cradle of innovation, because that is where the young minds are there. If you look at their students, undergraduate, postgraduate, doctoral, postdoctoral, they are all in the prime of their innovation phase of one's life. Innovative phase of one's life is starting from 15 to 30. This is the most innovative phase of one's life, creative life. That population is there in university. Mm-hmm. So they can think divergent, lateral, disruptive, See, if you see whether Facebook or any other, the you know, all that what we see today in the social media, it all started from our Infosys. Something started from university. Zuckerberg. All these people came from the in the dormitory of the Harvard University. The idea struck for him. So like this, university can become cradle of innovation. So when I retired from DRDO, I had 8 offers from university as chancellors, vice chancellors, and also from government, and also foreign university like York University, and even US Department of Defense, Defense Threat Reduction Agency. So I had 8 offers in hand, but I decided Amity. Because I know Amity, I know Dr. Ashok K. Chauhan, the founder president of this. Yeah. He himself is a great innovator, good human being. So I knew him, and he served in Germany. He worked in Germany. He is also from modest. Near Meerut. He hails from a village near Meerut. And then his father is teacher. And so he struggled, and then he didn't have money to go to Germany for PhD. So he got this, the DFG fellowship, a Dart fellowship. And then he went for study. And he went with 3 sterling pounds. He came with 1.6 billion US dollars. So what I'm telling is, people, if you can dream well, you can achieve anything. So I knew this man who is committed, and his dream is big dream. Like Dr. Kalam used to think big. He thinks big. Dr. Ashok Chauhan thinks big. So his aim is, he's today 11 universities in India, Amity universities, independent 11 universities in 11 states we have. And we have another 25 institutions like a Global Business School and so on. Then we have 17 campuses abroad, like Dubai, Mauritius, Singapore, London, Romania, China, USA, we have 3 campuses, Amsterdam, South Africa, Sharjah, Abu Dhabi. So like this, we have global presence. So I saw this man, Vision, now he wants to have every state of India, there must be one Amity University. And then there must be, that means we need to add another 18 more. Bangalore, we have already started the construction. And Mohali in Punjab, we have started the construction. And another one will be in Telangana. So we have already started planning to have every state in India must have one Amity University. The second is, today we have 17 campuses abroad. This should become 50. So it's a big goal, he says. And so this is what I like. NAM should be having targets and mission, big mission. So that fascinated me. So the liking for academia, and I myself was publishing papers when I was in DRDO. So I had the academic bent of mine. So it was a smooth transition from a government DRDO laboratory, where I functioned like a corporate. I functioned in DRDO, not like a government official or just the normal government official. I took decision. We took decision. And then we delivered, we performed, we worked 24/7. So that is the passion with which we delivered. So it was a very seamless transition from the DRDO to academia. So I didn't have any trouble at all. And then now here, as the president of Amity Science, Technology and Innovation Foundation, I'm taking care of all research and innovation in all campuses, including 28 schools we have. And then we have filed 1,330 patents. As you rightly said, next to IITs, it is Amity in India for the patents. But not only in patent, we are now translating them into product, technology, processes, taking it to the industry, taking it to the people. So that is Amity. And we also publish in good journals like Nature, Science, New England Journal of Medicine, The Lancet, The Cell, RSG, and also Advanced Horizon Materials and Physical Reviews. So such top journals we publish besides the publication. We have transferred 15 technologies to the industry so far, but then we have kept a very strong goal that every month at least one technology must go to the industry.
Dr. Sarvamurthy, I want to ask you, sir, like you are a person with the technology and you focus on research. Sir, our youngsters, those who are going for higher education courses like masters, M.Tech, PhDs, how to motivate them and provide them environment so that the research which they do, that should be purposeful research, not only to publish papers. It should be purposeful research, which is solving real life problem. And you are the epitome of that, sir. You have solved the real life problem of the soldiers. So how to make research for that particular thing?
In DRDO, we really practice that. You will see many spin-off technologies. Even though we develop for soldiers, it has spin-off benefit to the society. I'll mention a couple of them. Right. Biodigester. It was a hit as a spin-off technology because we developed for soldiers in high altitude who have to, the human waste will be there up to 20,000 feet altitude. So in snow, biodegradation will not happen. Microbes will not be there to biodegrade the human waste. So what we did, our scientists from DRDO, I sent them to Antarctica, brought a consortium of cyclophilic bacteria which functions there at low temperature in Antarctica, cultured them and provided the optimal conditions in the form of a biodigester. So we studied that what is the optimal temperature, minimum optimal temperature, and then what is the medium we should provide so that the digestion takes place. So studying all this, we developed the inoculum, a consortium of cyclophilic bacteria, which will work there. And then we put them in the high altitude. So in the cold conditions, we were able to degrade the human waste. Now that technology as a spin-off has gone to railways. Today you see the biotoilet in the railways. It is DRDO developed technology. Nice. So where almost 50,000 coaches have been retrofitted and all the new coaches which are being produced in railways are fitted with the DRDO technology, working with RDSO engineers. We have integrated in the railways. We have given it in Andaman Nicobar Islands. More than 11,000 units have been supplied there. And in villages, we have put that, including ITR, Balasur, and many other places. So this is one example. Similarly, the spin-off technology there in Ladakh, I already mentioned about the technologies there. And we developed something for the radio protection. Herbal radio protector. We can use it in the radiotherapy. So like this, there are many spin-off technologies, diagnostics for typhoid, leptospirosis, malaria, plague, anthrax. So we developed a number of them as a spin-off, including a critical care ventilator, which you see today during the COVID, that came to the rescue. Today, 30,000 have been produced using DRDO technology, which we initially gave it to Praikal in Coimbatore. Then ScanRay in Mysore took that technology for production. And today, 30,000 and Bell has upgraded that technology. 30,000 have been produced. It's DRDO. So what I'm saying is that culture I had developed even in DRDO, we were able to develop that culture. And so now when I came to this place, that the students must be exposed to real life problems of our nation first. So that is why that I brought the culture there in Amity as well. It was already the milieu was there, the ecosystem was there. And I only facilitated that to happen in the Amity as well. So what we did, that when you identify a PhD topic for research, we will say how relevant it is to the society in India. Yes. So we chose topics for PhDs. Now today we have 5,000 PhD scholars in Amity, 5,000. And so when we select the PhD topic, we see its relevance to the society. And whether it will be a deliverable coming out, or it is the first few steps to a deliverable. So always we keep, either it is leading to a product development, technology development, or a process development relevant to our national needs as well as societal needs. For example, I'll give a few examples for you to say, like we developed a technology to improve the productivity of the soil by a microbial technology. We developed a root endophyte, which is known as Piriforma spora indica, P. indica. And this gives protection against abiotic stress, like high temperature, low water availability, salinity of the soil, alkalinity of the soil. So we developed such things. Now that technology has been transferred to 5 industries, including one in Taiwan, Sinon Corporation has taken the technology. So I brought that culture of giving deliverable through our research and development. And we are executing 300 projects in Amit University. And we have filed 1,330 patents, more than 1330. And then we have delivered. So this culture, we brought it, and including even master's dissertation, M.Tech, M.Sc. dissertation, which they do in the last semester, 6 months, that is relevant to our society. So this relevance we bring, we take these people to the society as well. Like we have an Amity Humanity Foundation, through which we take our undergraduate, postgraduate student to villages, slums. So they should know the reality of life. The people at the bottom of the pyramid must also be known to the people. So we are giving that kind of culture in terms of selecting problems, real life problems, which will be useful. The outcome will be useful to the society.
Okay. Dr. Salvamurthy, government is coming out with what is called as Atmanirbhar Bharat or Self-Reliant India. Sir, what is your take on that?
It's a great initiative, Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi ji, and the present government has taken many, many revolutionary initiatives. Whether it is Atmanirbhar Bharat, or it is Startup India, Stand Up India, Swachh Bharat, and also now National Education Policy, which is a very revolutionary, with high aspirations, the policy has come out, National Education Policy 2020. So I find the Atmanirbhar Bharat is a great boon for our country, because self-reliance, a country which can send 6,000 kilometer a missile, a spacecraft, a Mars mission, a lunar mission, which is all complex missions with minimal input, that means we have the intellectual power in us. So that is one great strength. We have the human resource and the intellectual ability. With minimal resource, we can maximize our outcome. That is the Indian intellect power. So the Atmanirbhar is now looking at, with this potential, we are making atomic energy, we are making self-reliance in food, we are almost self-reliant now. So having achieved this, why should we keep importing many things? So we must promote indigenization, self-reliance. So Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan is actually looking at how do you achieve self-reliance in many areas. It cannot be 100%. No country will have 100%. But then in niche area, critical area, consumer goods, so that it is affordable, accessible, not only to the affluent middle class, higher middle class. I'm talking about people at the bottom of the pyramid, actually, to which I belong earlier. So you should address affordable, accessible products and consumer goods. So that is why Atmanirbhar is looking for frugal innovation, frugal solutions, so that everybody can afford such a technology. That is what Atmanirbhar. And now it can happen. The reason is we have 1,000 universities in India, almost 1,000 universities. Then we have 45,000 colleges and a few lakhs of schools. So we are churning out the future global citizens. This is what the Amity's mission as well. We are not there only giving degrees and placing them on the job. We are actually creating the future global citizen who will create a new world order, which will be seen by good health, abundance of peace and harmony, prosperity for everyone, and a happy world. So this is what Amity. So we are giving knowledge to our students, including spiritual knowledge, and skills, including soft skills. Skills means not only hands-on to do a job, but soft skills, behavior, communication. How do you think good for the society? So soft skills, and then values, very important, integrity. Now the value has been eroding. So we are now bringing back that value system, and also creativity, innovation, problem-solving ability, and resilience to face challenges. As life is full of challenges as well. It's not every time success and beauty, but there is also challenge. So how do you face with resilience such challenges? So we give that. Why I mentioned this, our Amity University system is contributing to this Atmanirbhar. all our technology development, research, everything is oriented to the indigenization, self-reliance, so which is already happening. And now today, R&D organizations like DRDO, Atomic Energy Space, CSIR, ICAR, ICMR, everybody has well-equipped labs, good, very educated, highly qualified, experienced faculty and young faculty, and researchers, scientists. So we have the human resource, we have the infrastructure for R&D, we have the enabling ecosystem, we have the policies, including science, technology, innovation policy, now with the national education policy. So the whole ecosystem is there. Now industry has also changed its mindset. About 20 years ago, they were doing only trade or license production, TOT. That was what was being practiced at that time. But now today, they are hungry for indigenous technologies. Yes, and they want indigenous, the developed design, indigenously designed products. Yes. So the now there is an attitudinal change in industry as well. Then MSMEs, which is major chunk of our industries, is MSME. So one side the major industries like L&T, Tata, Mahindra, Godrej, Reliance on one side. Then MSMEs, small, medium, micro, these industries, the government is taking care of. So this is the right window of opportunity for us to achieve self-reliance in many technologies. And then we should start exporting. Having met the needs of our people, then we must also export. Like COVID, like DRDO developed a number of technologies, including ventilators. We are now sending ventilator outside.
Yes.
We are sending PPE outside, the mask, including the mask, the N95, N99 mask outside. So this is what is happening now. So the Atmanirbhar is an excellent initiative by our Prime Minister and the government. And now apps, for example, they have started another mission. Why should we depend on apps from outside when we have brilliant computer scientists, information technology specialists, and our people are doing in Silicon Valley there. So why can't we use them to have our own apps? So we can, we need not import them. So like that in many areas, it will happen. And DRDO is also now mandated there. And Amity University is contributing immensely with dedication in all of our campuses to contribute to Atmanirbhar Bharat.
Dr. Selvamurthy, I think more or less we have discussed all the points and you have provided a lot of information to us, sir. So last couple of words from your side for all the youngsters, all the students, those who are going for higher education or those who are into technical field, last couple of lines from your side to them, sir.
So life is full of beauty, color, music, love, and open your eyes, open your heart, open your mind. Every journey of your life has to be happy and peaceful and beautiful. So for this, you must accept that you do your best. Give your, that karma yoga concept, that give your 100% to do a job with perfection. Strive for excellence. And then, if you have done that, there could be many extraneous factors which will decide whether you were 100% successful or 50% successful. Don't worry about that. You do your job perfectly. This is what I learned in my life. Whether I'm giving a lecture, I'm interacting with you now, that, you know, I give my 100% whatever I do. Yeah. And practice yoga, keep a good health, which is very important. I have been doing yoga for the past 45 years. I have never been admitted to a hospital during the last 70 years of my life. I never take any medicine now. I'm still very active. I go, I climb staircases very fast with students. I never use lift in the Amity University. So what I'm telling is, maintain good health. The message to my students is, you are not caring good for your health. At this age, you may be all right. When you come to my age of 70, you should be healthy like this or better than me. So keep good health. The other one is, keep good intellectual enrichment. Constantly update your knowledge. Because knowledge is now explosion. So you should be updated in current development in your domain, peripheral domains of yours, as well as generally what is happening across the globe, which is very important. You should be technology savvy, including computer savvy, IT savvy. So equip yourself with that. Then you must have a good mentors like I have. look for some gurus whom with whom you can learn, you can be with them, learn, like even Dr. Ashok Chauhan. He's a great unparalleled leader. I learned many things from him. So you must, every one of you must have a mentor, be with the good people, then you will, that itself will radiate that to you. So that is another message I want to give. And keep reading. Reading is very important. And then believe in God. Above everything, you should be a good human being and you must believe in God. That is what my destiny is, an example that a boy from a village, from a poor family, now coming to the level of DRDO and now the chancellor of a university. And you, if, and I'm not just boasting, but this journey itself is a providential. So this could be a model, certainly for some of the youngsters. And so I wish you all the best. Believe in God and do your best and keep happy everything. Because, you know, my rest of my phase of my life is to create a happy world. That is the mission I have taken.
Okay.
Until my next last breath of my life, I want to contribute to creating a happy world. So be happy in life. Not that only if I get a job, or not only when my system is inducted into the services, I'll be happy. Or when I get a promotion, I'll be happy. The journey, every moment has to be happy in your life. So this is what Amity also we do. Not only to be prepare our students to be successful and happy in life. So be happy and successful in life. And may God bless you all.
And thanks a lot, sir. It was a great honor for me to interview you. And we learned a lot of things from you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Rajinder, and I enjoy talking to you.
Thanks
and I'm sure that you will continue this mission. It's a very important mission you are doing. And may God be with you in your endeavors.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks to you as well. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.